Good evening, everyone. I'm Stuart McLaurin, the president of the White House Historical Association, and it's my honor and privilege to welcome you to episode number 4 of our quarterly lecture series, White House History, with the great, wonderful, awesome, and magnificent Frank Sesno. At the conclusion of my brief remarks, Dr. Matthew Costello, our Chief Education Officer, will give the formal introduction of our panel. But I want to take a moment to thank all of my colleagues, particularly Grace McCaffrey and our Public Affairs and Rubenstein Center colleagues who make this possible and bring this all together. And tonight we are joined by those watching on Facebook Live as well as our YouTube channel. So it's great to have all of you joining us who are not in the room with us here at Historic Decatur House. Well, this is the fourth in the series of lectures this year in 2023, this one on the 24-hour news cycle and social media, which will be, I'm sure, fascinating and compelling. It's a world that we live in and die in every day, and we look forward to hearing these four experts on this topic. I also want to recognize a dear friend who just came in the back, Dr. Martha Kumar, who is a longtime member of our board of directors. Thank you, Martha, for all that you do for us and have for a long time. With that, I have one presentation to make, and I would like to present Frank with this, a pocket-sized guidebook. In 1962, Mrs. Kennedy had us publish our very first book, The White House Guidebook. We are now in our 26th edition of the normal size. But for the first time ever, we have created this large, beautiful, extraordinary a book with images of the White House. It's actually a duplicate of the smaller guidebook, and we wanted you to have this, Frank. We were afraid you'd forget about us, so I think you'll trip across this and remember us from time to time.
As never. Thank you so much, Terry. I appreciate that.
Great. Thank you.
I'll
take it over here.
You take it. Okay.
And with that, I'd like to welcome my colleague, Dr. Matthew Costello.
Thank you, Stuart, and welcome everyone to Historic Decatur House. My name is Dr. Matthew Costello, and I serve as Chief Education Officer for the White House Historical Association. It is a pleasure to be here with you all as we culminate our quarterly series on the White House and the media. Tonight, we will learn more about how the 24-hour news cycle and social media have transformed the White House, the presidency, and the politics and policies of an administration, as well as how these things are discussed, reported on, and shared, not only with Americans, but the entire world. We have four fantastic participants joining us, led, of course, by our fearless moderator, Frank Sesno. Frank is an Emmy Award-winning journalist who currently serves as Director of Strategic Initiatives at the George Washington University School of Media and Public Affairs, where he also teaches classes on the art of the interview. Prepare for a master class. You're about to see it in real time here.
And I have a follow-up.
And a former CNN White House correspondent and Washington bureau chief, Frank has moderated this series on the White House and media masterfully, and we are truly grateful for his participation this year and supporting our mission as an organization. Now, joining him on stage, we have Darlene Superville, who has covered the White House for the Associated Press since the start of Barack Obama's presidency in January 2009. Before the White House, Darlene was a supervisor on the AP's National Political Desk in Washington during the 2000, 2004, and 2008 presidential election cycles. She also has covered Congress, among other assignments. Darlene is a native New Yorker, a graduate of NYU, and co-author with AP executive editor Julie Pace of Jill, a biography of the First Lady. To her right, we have Lisa Napoli. Lisa is a native of Brooklyn and a graduate of Hampshire College in Amherst, Massachusetts. She previously worked at a variety of news outlets, including the New York Times, Cyber Times, MSNBC, and the public radio show Marketplace, covering everything from presidential campaigns, artists in Los Angeles, the Waco hostage standoff, an outdoor hacker convention, and the then emerging culture of the internet and digital technology. She has written 4 books on a wide range of topics, from the dawn of democratic rule and media in the Kingdom of Bhutan to a famous fast food philanthropist to the unauthorized origin stories of 2 of the most iconic media outlets in American history. Welcome, Lisa. And finally, we have Jason Steinhauer. Jason is a public historian and the best-selling author of History Disrupted: How Social Media and the World Wide Web Have Changed the Past. He is the founder and CEO of the History Communication Institute, a global fellow at the Wilson Center, a senior fellow at the Foreign Policy Research Institute, and an adjunct professor at the Maxwell School for Citizenship and Public Affairs at the Center for Strategic and International Studies in Washington, D.C. He is also a contributor to Time, CNN, and Devex, a past editorial board member of the Washington Post, made by us, a past editorial board member of the Washington Post, made by us section, and a presidential counselor of the National World War II Museum. He is an expert speaker on disinformation and media literacy within the U.S. Department of State, and he has spoken at events across the United States and Europe. Please join me in welcoming our speakers this evening.
Well, thank you very much, Matt, and thank you, Stuart, and thanks to all of you who are here, and thanks to those of you who are joining us on Facebook, and special thanks to the panel. Before I get started, I just want to reinforce, Stuart, your enthusiasm for this series and the importance of it, and the importance of what the White House Historical Association stands for and does. Reinforcing our sense of history, understanding where we've come from, is essential if we are to understand where we are, and heaven forbid, where we're going. And when it comes to the White House and public perceptions of the White House, journalists, those the kinds of jobs we've done, we really are in that front row, and it really is the first very rough draft of history. And it does feel like we're writing that first draft a little faster now, courtesy of our digital technologies and what we've done. Certainly when I started at the White House, and I will date myself with Tyrannosaurus Rex, but the very revolutionary piece of equipment was called the Panifax machine. And it was pretty revolutionary at the time. And we had these little trash 80 computers. This was the first computer that, when I was on the first White House press charters, clack, click, 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 clack, 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 because people had little typewriters they carried. Typewriters, what a notion. And then this trash 80 came along and you could actually write your story on the trash 80, take the handset of a telephone, mm-hmm. put it in these two
the couplers.
Rubber cups.
They were called couplers.
Right, in the cups, and you could file it that way, and the revolution has continued. So it's been actually fascinating, phenomenal, terrific to see this change, but we've seen a lot of things that have happened with it. So how about a little amble through history? Okay, FDR, he was president, and he had this thing called the microphone, and he had this thing called radio. And you see in front of him there, MBS, Mutual Broadcast System, CBS, NBC, a handful of networks that brought the voice of the president to the country and the world. John Kennedy, that was a news conference, his first, and John Kennedy in the news conference discovered television and network coverage, changed the presidency, right? And for those of you who know or who remember the debate with Richard Nixon, those who listened on the radio thought, well, Nixon did pretty well. Mm-hmm. Those who watched saw Nixon's shadow and his sweat and said, Kennedy did better. The visual presidency as the camera takes over. Ronald Reagan, Mike Deaver, Reagan's image meister, had a great line. He said, my job is to light the president. And with Ronald Reagan, an actor, they knew that the set, the scene, the space mattered. And he took television to the level of art and, of course, was known as the great communicator. You may remember him, Barack Obama. He did the first Google town hall. He realized, you know, there's an audience out there and I don't need network television for that. I can reach them. in this new method, and in this new way, and all at once. And guess what? Young people like this. And then Donald Trump. Call it Twitter, call it X, call it Elon Musk's toy, whatever you want to call it. He understood the phenomenal power of this medium. And he used it to a fare thee well. And there is no politician that you can imagine who is not using some variation, right, of social media to communicate like this. So Lisa and Jason, I want to start with our historians. Where we are now, evolutionary or revolutionary? Is this just a logical progression and it's sort of more the same thing? Or because of the nature of the social media that bombards in and flies out of the White House, something fundamental has changed?
Can I choose both?
You know, it's go with it.
I think everybody here would probably, any thinking person would say it's a little bit of both. But I just think it's so phenomenal when you realize that 40 years ago, 43 years ago, when CNN started, June 1st, 1980, most people didn't have cable, and the idea of 24-hour news was bonkers. Who would want to watch news all the time? What a stupid idea. Who cares about the news that much? And Ted Turner wanted to put a satellite dish in the White House so that the 1 million people who could get CNN around the country were amplified by the very important press corps. So it's just an interesting thing how far we've come. I'm not answering your question like a good politician. Yes, I know, you're waiting for you. Okay. But it is impossible to, and we've had this conversation about technology for decades and decades. The good comes with bad, and it is both evolutionary and revolutionary. And I think, to me, teaching people media literacy is the way to counter the bad parts of both of those aspects.
So, Jason, when I was with CNN at the White House in 1984, there was no email, there was no internet, there certainly was no Fox or... And there certainly was no X or Twitter or Instagram or Snapchat or anything else that was out there. And when I stood on the lawn and I spoke, I felt it was me to you, me to the audience. And the audience was in receiving mode. And if they wanted to complain, maybe they picked up a phone and called, or they wrote a letter, literally. Now it's completely different. So this question to you, is it an evolution of these sorts of technologies and communication, or is it a revolution because of the way that people now can engage through this technology?
Well, first I will say that years ago I wrote a piece for the Foreign Policy Research Institute where one of my opening lines was, historians have the uncomfortable job of shattering people's memories. So I think one of the things we need to do when we have these conversations is we need to not nostalgize or romanticize past communication eras.
I'm not doing that just for
I'm not saying you are, but I'm saying we all need to, right? Past communication eras also had their complexities, also had their challenges, also had their disinformation and misinformation. Certainly in 19th century New York City, there were thousands of different newspapers published in dozens and dozens of different languages, and they were not all saying the same thing, reporting the same thing, or having the same message. So all these communication environments have been extraordinarily complex over time. And one of the things that historians try to do is try to suss out these eras on their own terms. Now, when it comes to this particular era that we're living in, I have heard in the past in the public sphere people making analogies to the invention of the printing press or the creation of the radio. And I think those analogies only take us so far because books and radio were not spying on us while we were using them, right? The current devices that we are using do spy on us every day. They collect our data and they use that data to target us for advertising and feeding us more information that they think we will like based on algorithmic designs and assumptions that go into those algorithms. So in that respect, I do think that this technology is very different and is in some level revolutionary because it has revolutionized not only the way we communicate, but the way that data about us is accumulated and collected, how that data is personalized and targeted for political purposes. And you mentioned the Trump campaign. Look no further than what was done in the Trump campaign with Cambridge Analytica. So I think certainly all these technologies and communications platforms build on each other. And there's certainly a lot of media logic from the prior century built into our current operating system. But this operating system is very different from one that we faced before because of the way the technology has been addictively designed.
Darlene, once upon a time, if you covered the White House, there was the briefing in the press room, maybe a backgrounder in the press secretary's office. Maybe you could get someone on a phone and go on background there or get them to speak on the record, God forbid. You'd stake out in the driveway. The senators are coming in, going out. Mm-hmm. You get a snippet of what's going on. What's it like now? What is a day at the White House like now with the constant social media, digital media as part of your life?
I would say a day at the White House now is much more hectic than it used to be, but some of the things that you just talked about, those elements still remain. We're still on the driveway waiting for people who've been meeting with the president to come out so we can buttonhole them, ask them questions. The press secretary still has a daily briefing most days of the week. Briefings, background briefings are still going on. But with social media and 24-hour television, it certainly has ramped up the pressure, I would say, on White House reporters, because you are responding to things instantaneously, a lot faster than you would before the introduction of those two mediums.
Is there such a thing as a news cycle anymore?
I don't think so. The news cycle is never ending. It is 24 hours. From the time you wake up in the morning until you go to bed at night, you're looking at your phone. However, whatever social media platform that you're on, you're constantly checking that to see what's happening, what the White House is putting out, what emails are coming out, what the president is tweeting. We had a president that tweeted a lot, and that was a big part of what we did when he was in office. You had to stay on top of his.
Tweeting is now rated X.
So
when I was at CNN, I would run out to the lawn every time I learned a little something. Mm-hmm. This just, you know, breaking news. The president is being briefed by his national security advisors. Okay, it actually would be news if he wasn't being briefed
right.
by his national security. But never mind, we would do that. And I started thinking of that as news by increment.
Yes.
Little itty-bitty things. But now, everybody does that, mm-hmm. right? The New York Times, Washington Post, the AP, live, 1048, someone says this. And you don't build the big roundup story anymore. So how has reporting the White House changed?
Again, I would say that it's changed just because we are reacting to what we see on cable TV, on social media, on Twitter a lot faster. The information is coming to you a lot faster. You know, 30 years ago, 40 years ago, it was just newspapers, radio, and TV that we had to worry about, the White House press corps. Now it's all these other platforms and ways that people not only get information, but put information out there, and we're responding to it in real time.
One more.
And you're also making judgment calls about
right.
what to.
One more on this, because I want, and then we'll go down. I want to bring Lisa and Jason into this. Do you use social media as a tip sheet? How do you use, as a journalist, mm-hmm. to break or report or advance a story? How do you use this technology?
It depends, but sometimes someone will tweet or X a piece of news, and if we don't have it, we see it there. And I'm not only talking about AP, but other journalists at other news organizations. And then we know something is happening, and we're starting to make calls, reach out to sources to get the same information.
So on January 6th?
Well, January 6th, that was broadcast live on TV, so we didn't need a tip sheet or a tip to report on what was happening. We also had reporters in the Capitol who were there when it was all going down. So that's a little bit of the difference.
Lisa, what about quality control? You know, you wrote very persuasively, and you experienced when Ronald Reagan was shot, early days in CNN, and there was a kind of an exemplary process there. You want to talk about that and how that applies to where we are today?
It's an incredible moment in time, and you can watch it all on YouTube. In 1981, just as CNN was about to file for access to the White House press pool, from which it was prohibited because it was a new startup and the three networks had the stranglehold triopoly on news coverage, CNN was going to file on the day that the president was shot, President Reagan was shot, and they didn't file the lawsuit for access, and instead they had to scramble and get the footage. You all may remember that footage outside the hotel. That I believe it was ABC was the pool camera that day. They had that video, and you know, this was an example early on of watching something over and over again. It was repeated with the Shuttle Challenger a few years later, where you just kept seeing the slow-mo of the president going down and this terrible, terrible incident. But what Frank is asking about is how that was an indelible change in the way we covered a breaking news. Of course, the shooting of a president is always going to be major news, but at a time before we as a culture were used to getting news instantaneously. Basically, CNN broke in. All the networks broke in, but how they handled it is very telling and very interesting. Bernard Shaw, the late Bernard Shaw, the great news anchor who was the first at the helm of CNN, was loath to go on the air and say, to report news because there wasn't sourcing. But the networks went on the air and gave erroneous news because they were so afraid about the fact that CNN existed, CNN, which nobody really knew much about or had seen much about. They were basically running to report whatever they heard in the field. And of course, like any chaotic day, they were hearing all manner of things without being able to verify it quickly. Today, that happens much more, right? Mm-hmm. You know, you have to go on and then you'll come back and say, whoops, sorry, we were wrong. But back then, there was still this gold standard of do not report something major until detail until you absolutely have verified it three or four times. And in this case, the networks, which were freaking out about how to handle this concept of 24-hour news, went on the air with erroneous information, and Bernard Shaw would not.
So, Jason, let's talk about erroneous information and how that does or doesn't course through our veins today, right? So once upon a time, there were editors and producers who said, no, you can't put this on the air. And now you're your own producer or editor, and you put on the air whatever you want, which may or may not be right. A contemporaneous example I saw just yesterday, I want to call them AI photographs, but they're not really, but they're altered photographs from Gaza, right? Mm. And they're out there. And I dare you to look at that picture and know that that's not real. So how do we contextualize, especially at the White House, where the stakes are so high, right? And how do you contextualize what's happening in the sort of accurate and inaccurate gate?
Well, that's a very complicated question. I give lectures about this for hours or two at a time when I'm traveling around the world with the State Department. I would say this, a couple of things. I think at the heart of this question, in one sense, is this question around gatekeepers, right? And I think journalism, like the profession of history, has sort of evolved to have gatekeepers and speed bumps built into the system, right? When it comes to the academy and scholarship, for example, we have something called peer review. And so when you write a scholarly book or a scholarly article, several different scholars in your field look at that before it even has a chance of getting published, right? And that peer review acts as a gatekeeper. It also acts as a speed bump to try to make sure that things that are inaccurate or not quite right don't get out into the public sphere and cause harm. Journalism has something similar with editorial controls and fact-checking. A lot of social media has been built and constructed with the sole purpose of bringing down those gates and removing those barriers, right? The goal is to get you to publish and post as quickly and as often as possible, because these platforms make money the more times people publish and post on them. And they also make money the more times people engage with those published posts. So the whole ecosystem has been built in many ways to remove speed bumps and to remove gatekeepers. Now, there is a democratizing aspect to that, which we can't overlook, because the professions like journalism and history have also traditionally kept a lot of people out because of its gatekeeping function. For a long time, there were certain people who couldn't be historians, who couldn't be journalists, for a lot of different reasons, which we can talk about. And so there's this question about democratizing access and democratizing the ability to publish and post with the desire to get it right and to be accurate and to try to ground things in evidence. And there are actors out there, unfortunately, working on the social web every single day who do not care about accuracy or grounding things in evidence. They care about crafting narratives that will divide, that will persuade, that will advance political, commercial, and economic agendas, and it creates an enormous burden on we, as the information-consuming public, to sort out the agendas and figure out what information to trust. And so this is the conundrum that we have all built for ourselves. We are all complicit in it.
So, Darlene, bring that back into the White House for us. And just let me, thinking what Jason said, provide an example. There was a time when we would not put on the air news of a bomb scare because you don't want to reward the person who's doing something like that. There was a time when we said, we're not going to put certain things on the air that we hear from other people until we can confirm it ourselves with our own two sources. But I know that in several news organizations, that's changed because people have said at the executive level, well, gosh, it's gone virtual. We can't ignore it. People are seeing it, even if we have to tell them we don't know or we don't. So how, bringing that into the White House, how do you manage on a daily basis when the information is flying and the disinformation is flying, your own coverage decisions about what the president has said or what a critic has said or what a demonstration is demanding?
That's when you kick it up to a news editor and let your manager make the decisions. But seriously, you would, I mean, we, with all the news, 90% of what we write at the White House, our managers are involved. We have a White House news editor, and sometimes things go up to the bureau chief, and depending on the sensitivity of the issue at hand, it will even go up to our executive editor in New York, which is where AP is headquartered. So we still have gatekeepers who are working with us to figure out whether it's something we can run with. Do we need another source? Should we hold off? Should we root around ourselves to figure out whether it's real or fake?
Let me do a jump ball here and talk about agenda setting and how this has changed agenda setting. So there was a time when the communications director at the White House said, today is going to be Immigration Day, or today is going to be the Arts Day. And they would have a statement, and the president would say something publicly. All the other cabinet members would be told not to say anything, and reporters would dutifully pick it up. Or a publication would say, we're going to do a week-long series on whatever the topic was. How has agenda setting changed in this more democratized and digital and social media chaotic world?
Have you heard of the phrase, it's trending? That is one of the ways that some of this has changed. In news organizations, and to some degree at AP, if something is trending on social media, I don't have a good example right now to toss out there, but maybe something involving a celebrity or an influencer or somebody like that, then we'd have to try to pull together our own story, because it's trending, people are reading it on social media, and therefore we also want to be out with a story of our own on whatever is trending. So that's one of the ways that this evolution or revolution, however you see it, is influencing some news decisions.
Lisa, what do you think?
You know, I'm thinking about how in 1979, Susan Stamberg, who was the first female national news anchor of a news program, broadcast news program, sat down with President Carter. I'm not going to answer your question again. I'm going to tell you an anecdote. And she sat down with President Carter in the Oval Office, and they did one of the very first call-in radio talk shows. And apparently President Carter loved going out into the public and meeting people and taking extemporaneous questions from people. But that was in a room like this. It wasn't being aired out in all kinds of places. But in this case, they had thousands of people write in who had questions, and they cataloged them on note cards. The idea, I think you're absolutely right, that the agenda is set now by the people, and the people as directed by social media. Apparently, did you see the Pew report that some huge number of people are getting their news from TikTok now, adults? That's driving what the agenda is. But back then, there was still creeping in, like Jason was saying, it was still creeping in that the president was eager to hear what the people were thinking about, what was on their minds. And that's one example of how he agreed to put himself out there. I mean, he could have been embarrassed, but he was willing to listen to the people. That, as you say, though, that was incredibly unusual.
Okay, so let's go from that, the people, to today's the people. And Jason, you have this very interesting observation that social media platforms do not elevate experts. And here we're talking about setting an agenda. And there are times when the White House agenda is very urgent. The country's been attacked. There's a war going on. There's a pandemic that's taken place. There's a financial panic. And, you know, we talk about the president as the commander-in-chief or the mourner-in-chief. But if social media platforms do not elevate experts or expertise, what does that do to the platform and the credibility of the President of the United States when he or she tries to speak from the White House?
Yeah, so let me answer this with an anecdote, which I think people will find is kind of funny. So the Biden White House has been trying very hard to cultivate influencers as a way to get its agenda and messaging out to a younger public. Now, if you're not familiar with the term influencer, this refers to people on social media who have a lot of influence. They usually have influence because of the number of followers they have. Maybe they have 2 million followers on TikTok or 1 million followers on Instagram. But there's other ways you can have influence as well on social media. So the Biden White House invited a bunch of TikTokers and Instagrammers to the White House last year because it wanted to brief them on the war in Ukraine and the Biden administration's position on the war in Ukraine. And it wanted those influencers to then go out and talk to their audiences about the importance of supporting the war in Ukraine. And then this year as well, the Biden White House has been inviting TikTokers and Instagrammers to the White House for similar briefings on other policy issues to further its agenda. Okay, so this seems like a great idea in practice, but this is social media in a nutshell. So which viral video ends up coming out of this, at least the one that reached my eyes and attention? One of the people that was invited to the White House as an influencer turns out to be like an AV nerd, okay? So for my guys in the back here who are doing the camera work, this guy's really into like wiring and how you tape the wires and how you attach the microphones and the camera positioning, all that stuff. And he makes this TikTok video about how terrible the wiring is inside the White House. Okay? How all the cables aren't bundled, how their wires are like 15 years old. He's like, have these people heard of Bluetooth, right? And so this is the video that ends up going viral, right? Gets hundreds of thousands of views on TikTok. So the agenda is lost in that, right? It gets totally subsumed by these other sort of funny, wacky, irreverent types of videos that get made when people get invited to the White House. And I think that is an illustrative example because on some level, all of TikTok is irreverent. I mean, that's how the platform kind of became famous, right? There's a certain, as you say, antipathy towards expertise that's sort of built into these platforms. I talk about this in my book, Wikipedia, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, TikTok, they all have this sort of like flipping the world upside down sort of motif to them. And that irreverence for authority, that sort of wanting to flip the script, the wanting to go into the most sacred place in American politics and point out how badly taped the microphone cables are, like that is so epitomizing of what the culture of social media is and the risk that comes with trying to work with that contingent of people to advance a very specific political agenda.
Yeah, but I'm back struggling with the evolution versus revolution again because when I was at the White House, I covered wars, you know, presented wars, presented superpower summits. The president did budget deficits and negotiations. You know what the most popular story was on CNN when I was at the White House? The Easter egg roll. People love that stuff. All right, so take what Jason was talking about and bring that back into how you're working, right? Are you dealing with things that go viral, right? Because you're aware that it's going viral. If you're a reporter, whether that's, again, very serious, something that's gone via social media and then shocked people, like the images out of Gaza, which may drive your questions to the press secretary or somebody else, or something that's very personal and painful, something that's off the streets of America, or something that's wacky.
We respond to all of it, I would say. So there is an element of responding to what's out there on social media. I'm not on TikTok personally, so I didn't see that video that Jason talked about. But we also, AP, we have reporters all over the world, so we can be in touch with colleagues in Jerusalem, for example, with what's going on right now. They have questions for the White House. They will send them to us when we get an opportunity to ask the press secretary. That's kind of how we operate. So there's a little bit of that. There's a little bit of responding to the social media, the outside pressures. And there's also some responding to what other reporters and news organizations are also reporting. So it's a broad mix of things that we're responding to, not just one thing.
What's the best thing about that broad mix of things?
The best thing?
For your journalism, for your reporting from the White House.
For my reporting from the White House, I would say just the access that I have or that my colleagues and I have to other AP journalists around the world.
What's
because
the word?
They can, you know, they can also help us figure out what's real, what's reality, what's true, what's false.
What's the worst or most disturbing thing?
I think probably just the having to respond to some of the stuff that's out there. Like the things that are trending, or having to write about celebrities when I maybe want to write about something else.
And that's in response to things that are trending. So
yes.
Suddenly you've got an editor saying, you got to do this.
Can you do something? Can you do 200 words on celebrity Y who showed up at the White House or something like that?
You're shaking your head.
No, it's funny because when I was at the New York Times in the early days of the internet, I fought to get my lisa@nytimes.com email at the end of my story. Mm-hmm. And when someone wrote into me, and had a legitimate story, I would go to my editors and they would be very skeptical about it. So I'm thinking about just how far we've come or not come in the terms of interactivity with the audience and the audience driving the bus, so to speak.
Jason, don't our journalists now have a fundamentally different relationship with their audience because
100%.
Of this? You're more accountable. You're also more subject to attack. But hasn't that been a fundamental change?
Yeah, I mean, I think all the relationships have evolved. I mean, my sister is a journalist, and at one publication she was working for a few years ago, she was asked to write 4 stories a day.
I mean, wow.
Is that all?
That's insane.
Wow.
I mean, to write, but that was the demand of the website, of the cycle, of getting things up, of constantly, you know, commenting on things that are trending or things that are popping up on social media that they felt they needed to have a response to, or at least a story about. The quality of the stories was not very good. Eventually she left that job and went somewhere else because she was getting burnt out. But the relationship between readers and journalists, editors and journalists, the business models, all of it has completely changed.
How has the stature and the profile of the President of the United States changed because of all of this?
That's an interesting question. I mean, the President of the United States is always going to command attention just by the nature of who he or someday she is. But they are relying on more on social media. President Biden's on social media. He's got a Twitter account. He's on Instagram. You know, they're doing those things with him as well.
Is he really tweeting?
I got a tweet from him today and Kamala asking me to go have coffee with them.
Yeah, you think they wrote that?
I'm absolutely sure they didn't. It was participating.
Well, there they are now.
They're calling.
See, you got the call. I just got a text. They wanted me to put money in to be part of some sweepstakes.
That
I can't even
campaign,
say the word.
For the campaign.
I guess so,
yeah.
But I just was shocked because it was so vernacular. I was just, yeah.
Jason, you're one of the historians here, and let's do this, and then I, in a couple minutes, want to turn to the audience for your questions, and I've already told my good friend Etta that she's got to have the toughest question in the room, so we'll have some good ones. You know, John and Abigail Adams wrote long letters, and we have that for history. Many, many presidents wrote and kept diaries. And now we wonder about that. Now we have tweets and we have other things. How will this social media environment, this digital environment, change the way history gets to know and record people who occupy 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue?
Ah, this is one of my favorite questions. Okay. I get asked this question a lot in various permutations. I'll answer it similarly to how I've answered it before. First of all, this assumes that there will be future historians to write about 1600.
Oh,
now, if you've read my book, History Disrupted, or if you have an interest in reading my book, History Disrupted, you will know that the last chapter is, does history have a future? And I'm not sure that it does. I want it to. I've been working to advocate for it. That's why I have my History Communication Institute. But one of the reasons the book is called History Disrupted is because when I was interviewing people for my book, I consistently heard from them, why should I take a history class when I have YouTube? Why should I pay a history professor to teach me something about history when I could learn it from Wikipedia? So the web and social media have fundamentally disrupted where people seek out historical information, and also it has convinced people, in some degree, that they no longer need professional historians to teach them anything about history. Now, the irony of all this is that the YouTube videos and TikTok videos and Wikipedia posts that post about history are getting their information from professional historians, right? They're not doing the original research themselves. However, if we don't fund professional history, if we don't make the argument for professional history and the work that scholars do to continue to be a part of our life, then we will not have professional historians in the future to examine things like the presidency. Now, let me move to my second answer to that question, which is the other question I would ask is, yes, we have this massive social media universe. There are 167 million videos being watched on TikTok every single minute of every single day.
Oh my God.
Okay, do that math. It's a lot of videos. Wow. Who's preserving any of this? I mean, I used to work at the Library of Congress. The Library of Congress tried to preserve Twitter. I can't talk about what happened, but you can read about it online.
Oh, we're off the record. We're friends.
yeah, he says in front of the camera. But Facebook posts by the billions, TikTok videos by the billions, Instagram posts by the billions. I mean, where is all this stuff going to live? Where is this digital history being preserved, if anywhere? The Internet Archive doesn't have all of it. LOC doesn't have all of it. National Archives doesn't have all of it. So the irony of all of this is that we are drowning in information with hundreds of millions of videos circling across the web every single minute of every single day. And it is possible that no one in the future will ever be able to find them or see them.
So how does that affect how we will remember and record our presidents?
Well, I think there's a couple things that I like to continually argue to people, which is if you want this record of history to be preserved, it has to be funded, right? And infrastructure has to be built. And the people who do the work have to be able to have a living wage and be able to, you know, live inside Washington, D.C. or New York City or wherever else they want to live. So we have to, if we feel like that's important for future journalists and future biographers and future historians to have a full record of this historical time period and be able to mine it to see what we missed or to understand the things that we didn't understand in our current time, we have to fund it and we have to build the infrastructure for it. And so that's what we're trying to do at the History Communication Institute. And if you're interested in that, talk to me afterwards. But I think to your point, like, talking about it is one thing. We actually have to do it, right? And if you look across our public space right now in the United States, we're not really doing it. We're underfunding all these institutions that are important to future journalists and biographers and historians to have that record.
I just want to say that the concern that I've got, obviously, is that the personal correspondence, the diary, the introspection that a president might have had could be washed away in just a sea of posts and tweets, and it just becomes more and more sanitized as people also get concerned, you know, more worried about something being subpoenaed or something being spied on. Darlene, I want to give you the last word before we go to the audience. You know, when you think about how the president communicates now in this world, mm-hmm. Joe Biden did a news conference the other day.
Yesterday.
What numbered news conference was that for him? Like 3 or something like that?
No, more than that.
Well, but he has not done very many.
He hasn't done very many solo formal news conferences at the White House.
Right. So the primetime news presidential news conference is all but gone.
Yes.
Okay. The Oval Office speech is an incredibly high bar, where it used to be not normal, but it was not the high bar that it is now. So how do you think this world that we've been talking about here, how does a president, from your coverage, mm-hmm. communicate with the nation?
Through all of the different mediums. Television, radio, newspapers, even though they're in decline, are still important. Although I don't think he's given any interviews to newspapers, but he's doing television, he's doing influencers, I can't even say it right. He's done some TikTok stuff. And you know, the White House has to meet the people where they are, right? So if 90% of the people are on social media, the White House has to figure out how to put the president on social media to reach those people. And they're doing that.
I lied. Lisa, last one to you. Then I promise we'll go to the audience. You've written biographies. I'm interested in your response to that question I was asking, Jason. How do presidents get remembered?
Well, thankfully, there are archivists whose job it is to handle the president's material. But I happen to be in a graduate program as a student at CUNY in New York. It's a biography and memoir program. And so there are many people who come to this program who are keenly aware of archives, the importance of archives, and they want to access archives and do the deep research into them. So I hear what you're saying about funding them, but I feel like TikTok stars will probably archive their own materials, and if they become famous, leave them to the Ransom Center in Austin or wherever they will. Perhaps, I know that's ludicrous, but maybe it isn't. Maybe it isn't so ludicrous. The research libraries are acquiring people's digital archives. Yours is probably going to be obtained by GW in their special collection, right? You can, sell it. Get a good price. But there are people, I guess what I'm saying is that there are people who are deeply interested, as many people as there are interested in the tweet and the moment, there are people, not quite as many, who are deeply interested in doing the digging and doing the archiving and the researching. So I feel uncharacteristically, for me, optimistic that those people will be out there looking for the depth.
It's an appropriate, as I turn to the audience, it's an appropriate moment to give a plug to the White House Historical Association and presidential libraries, because they are troves.
Right, exactly. Yes.
I buried myself. I did a documentary I did one for CNN and one for the History Channel on Ronald Reagan, and I spent a lot of time in libraries, and it is phenomenal what you find, and just presidential notations in the margins. Just you can't even imagine it and how it's explosively interesting that is.
Yeah.
Speaking of explosively interesting, should we go to the audience? Who wants to get us started? There's a question all the way in the back. Please tell us who you are and go for it.
My name is Hunter. I'm here with my dad, and I was wanting to know, with the growth and prevalence of AI and Photoshop, how do we know if we see Joe Biden or a future president online, if it is actually them?
That's a great question, but before we answer it, I want to ask you a question. What grade are you in? Why are you interested in presidential history? Why are you here tonight?
I'm in seventh grade. I'm interested in history because we moved to Washington, D.C., and I think the coolest thing about it is the history.
Yeah.
Because
so you're going to tell him he's wrong and there is Okay. Great question. How do we know that what we're seeing is actually Joe Biden?
That is a great question. President Biden recently announced some standards for AI. One of the things that he's trying to encourage some of the companies that are developing AI to do is to include watermarks on their images and whatever they produce so that you can know that it is actually AI generated. That's about the best that I can do for you in terms of an answer. I'm sorry.
Anything else?
Well, first of all, if you love history, we should talk. Also, if you're new to Washington and you haven't been to the Library of Congress yet, you gotta go. And you're very lucky, because tonight, Connie is in the audience. Connie worked at the Library of Congress for 50 years. She knows everything about that institution, so you two should talk.
You got some serious networking to do here before you.
Connie, literally a living legend. It's amazing. So you're in luck. But your question is a great one. And yes, so the White House just put out an executive order on artificial intelligence. And one of the items in that EO was to put watermarks on AI generated material. Keep in mind, this is an executive order. So it's not binding, right? It's not legislation. So will companies actually do that or not? I think that's TBD. The other thing is to recognize, as you said, that at this point, many of these tools are off-the-shelf tools that people can either develop or purchase and have in their own homes. So you know, it doesn't take a lot these days to train your own language bot. And that language bot can do all kinds of crazy things, say all kinds of crazy things, and then you can leverage the power of the social web to get those crazy things out into the public sphere where they can be believed by anybody. So I don't think that there's a really good answer to this question yet, but I always go back to education, right? We have to educate people about not only how these technologies work, but how to recognize and spot what they're doing in the real world and what techniques they are leveraging in order to get in front of people's eyes. Because if we teach people about that, then we make ourselves more savvy information consumers. There's only one state right now, to my knowledge, in the United States that mandates media literacy as part of its education.
Wow.
That is New Jersey,
Wow.
as far as I know, unless something has changed recently. So we have a lot of work to do in our own country to build media literacy as a mandatory requirement, to make information savvy consumers, to teach people about how these technologies work and why they work the way they do, and what mechanics they leverage in order to achieve visibility. That doesn't even include all the people around the world. When I gave a talk at the Bulgarian Naval Academy, I asked every single cadet if they used ChatGPT, and they all raised their hands.
Wow.
So we have a huge challenge in front of us, and we need to put the resources and the funding behind it so that we can make some inroads.
I think ChatGPT is the greatest thing. I typed in the other day, because I have a 2.5-year-old grandson. He's really cool. And I have another littler one who's 2 months old. And my wife is a musician. So I said, write me a story that sounds like Dr. Seuss for a two-month-old about music. Boom, it was there. It was brilliant. It was a little stiff, and I didn't misrepresent. I said ChatGPT did this. Fits. But but no, I think it's a real serious thing. This is probably where I think the most revolutionary thing in what we're talking about has taken place. The burden of accuracy and assuring accuracy has gone from what was editors, producers, and the gatekeepers to you, the news consumer. You don't have that gatekeeper often between you. And thinking that Google's going to do it or X is going to do it, we're probably misleading ourselves. Okay, another question. Anybody on this side of the room? Back there. And then I'll come across.
Thank you so much for the
Stand up so we can see.
Thank you guys so much for this great discussion. My question is actually related, Frank, to kind of what you just mentioned. Do you think that the power of journalism today and the power of journalists has been diluted compared to what the power was kind of in the past, related a little bit to that gatekeeper? Because back, you know, like before, I guess, the internet or before social media, journalists were able to craft stories or take a little bit more time, I think you guys talked about, right, going to incremental news. And even if, you know, you try to portray a story in its truest form, there's always a little bit of spin or always a little bit of analysis that goes into a piece. Today, when everything is rapid response, when a president is followed around with 100 phone cameras everywhere he goes, does that power that journalists have to really tell that story in a detailed way, in an analytical and thoughtful way, just get lost in the mess of everything else going online with, you know, everyone who's a self-proclaimed journalist who started a Twitter account yesterday?
Great question. Lisa, you want to
Everybody's start? A journalist. You're right. Today, who is a journalist? What's a journalist? There's no delineation. So I think you're absolutely right. It's an old, we know what it means to be a journalist. Many people in this room know what it was like when you watched or read the news and there were standards, but I think next generations are largely, everybody's empowered.
Darlene, is the role of the journalist diminished, do you feel? You still do this for a living?
Yep, I still do it for a living every day. I would say yes, a little bit, just because the table, there's just so many more places now where people are getting information, and a lot of those people don't want to come to people like me or someone from the New York Times or the Washington Post or ABC News. We're seen as traditional media, establishment media, and they want the video, the quick wit that's out there on social media, so on and so forth. So to a degree, I would agree with your question a little bit, but there is still a place for journalists like myself and some of the other outlets that I mentioned, because
because of our reputations, the way we go about doing our journalism, the fact-checking, the context that we provide, the history that's in some of our stories, there are still people who appreciate that and gravitate toward that.
I hope so.
And I would like to say, I do think there's a very big distinction, and maybe we can explain this more in our media literacy classes, between citizen reporting and citizen journalism. Okay? The citizen can hold up the phone and capture an image, and you're reporting what took place. The journalism that you're talking about, that requires sources, attribution, fact-checking, time, checking it out with your counsel to make sure that you're not libeling somebody or whatever it is, that's a craft.
But
that's a profession.
But that requires teaching Hunter and everybody in that generation what that is. The Kingdom of Bhutan, when it introduced television, tiny Himalayan kingdom introduced television 20-something years ago. They did not have TV until then. And as a requirement with the introduction of television was media literacy in all the schools. Everybody had to learn how to read the media. Now, that's a different proposition than doing that here. And I don't know if it's changed.
I think it's very important, but sort of, who tells you what to read and how to read?
Well,
who makes that decision?
That's the next question.
That's not easy. Another question from the room. Martha.
Oh, thank you. You've talked about change. What about continuities? What continuities do you find during the time period, like, say, for example, when CNN went on? Is the nature of what a story, a White House or a presidential story, has that changed, even though there are many more of them a day? There are important continuities, I think, over time.
Continuity?
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
Everybody still looks to the AP and the New York Times and the Washington Post as the standard bearers, not the gatekeepers, but you set the agenda for what everybody covers, and they rip you off too. Or I mean, they're supposed to with AP, right? They're supposed to take your stories and
They pay for our stories.
They do. You're right.
So they can do.
Rip off is the wrong word.
There's a concept.
Borrow. Right. Right. But I think that's consistent.
Yeah.
What about the nature of the story?
Is the story different?
There are certain things that happen at the White House or that are done at the White House that will always be a story. I would say that in the time that I've been on the White House beat, there are some things that we did when I first joined that we don't do today.
Like what?
Well, the radio address went away, for example, the presidential radio address. They would do that every Saturday, put it out, it would go out on radio. Then once video became a thing, there was a video component, and that was pushed out on the internet. And we would write, we would write that every Saturday. And after a while, our bureau chief said, let's see what happens if we don't write about this. Let's see if any of our members will call and ask for it. There was a time when they were being used to make news. President Obama used the radio address to announce cabinet appointments and such. But it just became rhetoric, and so we got rid of it. And so that's an example of something that we don't do anymore.
What are things that you do? You're the nature of what's a story. What information do you look for a presidential story?
Something that's interesting, something that's newsworthy. Urgency is a part of White House stories. Lots of people like to read about behind the scenes at the White House, what the family is doing, what the pets are doing.
The taping.
Those things go into stories at the White House, so it all depends. Right.
They're interested in presidential appointments. So there are really some continuity.
Is that still newsworthy when there's a reception, the social life and the social scene at the White House?
The social scene, yes, with state dinners and some of the more...
As much as ever, more or less?
I think as much as ever,
So there is some continuity.
So there's continuity
there. Okay, yes, question. There's a mic for you.
What do you think the percentage of people today versus
15 years ago as well as 15 years coming, rely on the Washington Post and the New York Times and similar types of publications for news?
I think the number is huge. It's probably as big or bigger.
Percentage.
A percentage? Oh, I don't know. I mean, anybody want to try percentages?
All you read is about what people spend their time on social media.
But a lot of the social media is actually echoing and rebroadcasting some of these legacy medias. Mm-hmm. You know, so there's a lot of, if I talk to my students about where do you get your news, they'll say TikTok or they'll say whatever. And then I'll say, well, what are you reading? And they'll cite a story that is a Washington Post story or something else. So there's a lot of that, and it's very, in fact, I remember when going into the Washington Post newsroom a few years ago, there's a big screen on the when you walk in, and it showed the stories that were, you know, that were getting the most
the trend.
Traffic,
trending.
And where that traffic was coming from. And the most populated spot was at the top was Facebook. So it was people coming to the Post through Facebook. So I don't know how to measure that, but okay, we've got time for a couple more, one, two, and then we've got to let you all get on with your evening. And then, we're one, two, three. Go ahead.
Thank you. I just wanted to ask if there's anything that professional journalists could do to potentially influence the difference between advocacy from social media and actually receiving real news from social media.
Okay, there you go.
You don't have enough else to do.
Influence advocacy?
No, try to shift the focus from advocacy from civilians to how they can get people to care about the actual facts of news.
Are you actually talking about trying to change social media or the people on social media?
Yeah, changing from a professional.
Good luck.
I think the only thing that we can do is just to continue to put out stories that are rooted in facts and truth and history and context and just be true to the core mission of what journalism is. Because a lot of what you're talking about, I think, comes from the people. And so the people have to be the ones to shift their orientation to going to finding facts versus noise or untruths.
Jason, you have a brief thought on that?
Yeah, I guess I want to be careful a little bit because a lot of advocacy is based in facts and journalism, right? I mean, if you're advocating for environmental justice, it's because there's a lot of evidence to suggest that there's been a lot of environmental injustice. And a lot of that is based on reporting, and it's based on the work of historians, and it's based on actual evidence of years and years of malfeasance and malpractice. So I'm not really sure that the line and distinction is all that clear. I think it's very fuzzy and muddled, and I think one of the reasons there is so much advocacy on social media is because oftentimes the presidency and the Congress and our institutions of power have not done enough to actually remedy people's problems. And so they have to organize in the streets and on social media to demand that policymakers take their concerns seriously.
Okay, let's come over here for a couple last questions.
Thank you. For someone who's taught university for 13 years and is a colleague of these two wonderful young ladies, the thing, Frank, when what's at stake for the American people, when the president and the White House understands what's at stake. Now, we saw a press conference yesterday that was truly incredible. I mean, so it looks like these two guys are going to get along. I mean, they met for 4 hours. I wrote about it this morning. When the American people know what's so important and what's at stake, and the White House understands that, then they can direct their message to that and hopefully get people on board or explain what's so important about why he went to the APIC conference yesterday. Darlene?
Yeah, that's absolutely right. And this morning, the White House released on Twitter, I think there was a video of him with President Xi, so they realized the importance of the meeting as you just described it and are trying to push that out to people to get them to, you know, understand the same thing too. They have who?
Pandas.
Oh, pandas.
That'll be a big story.
That'll be a bigger story.
Last question,
sadly, right.
From the floor.
My question is kind of about the president's relationship with communicating with the American people. So when we started out, there were pictures of FDR using radio to speak to a nation at war, a nation that was scared, comforting them. And then we progressed through that maybe to the Kennedys, where even First Lady welcomed the nation into the White House in her famous tour. Nowadays, we have so many different tools, different outlets, different journalists. Everyone's a journalist. It seems that perhaps, and this is what I would like your opinion on, has the president's relationship with communicating with the American people moved from using a new tool to fulfill a duty to communicate to having so many tools that it's almost a burden to communicate with the American people because of opinions, instant feedback, all of those things? And has that changed the president's relationship with the American people?
I'm going to turn to Jason, but I thank you for the question. It's a great question. Just think of the pictures, though. Think of the first one and the last one. The first one with FDR sitting in front of three or four microphones. That's all there was. The last one with President Trump, with everybody with a camera. A burden?
Well, okay, a couple things. Earlier this week, I was at a conference here in Washington, D.C., and one of the people speaking on the conference was an FTC commissioner. And she was talking about regulating social media companies. And she made the point, which I agree with, that it's not necessarily handed down from God to Moses at Mount Sinai that social media companies have to operate the way they do. They've chosen to do so. They've made a lot of money doing so. So as a result, if there's a burden on them to comply with the regulations that are set forth by the FTC and others, that is what they signed up for. I feel similarly about the presidency. The president works for us. We elected him. It's his job to be responsive to us. It's his job to communicate with us. If he or she doesn't want that job, they shouldn't run for president. So I don't really see it as a burden. I see it as part of the job. And that part of the job has changed over time. And so as a result, we need to hold them to the standard of the times. And the times are right now that they have to use a lot of platforms. And you'll be relieved to know that he's got a whole team that does this. It's an Office of Digital Strategy inside the White House. I know the director's name is Christian Tom. So they got a lot of good, smart people working on all these platforms doing this work. If that's a burden for getting a six-figure government salary inside the White House, I think that's a burden that they can live with.
I want to just take a swing at that, because I agree, but I also disagree.
Yes.
It is just much harder to govern today at any level. Think of your mayor, think of your governor, think of your school board, right? And, you know, when I was there at the revolution, when CNN went barging in, it was like, oh my God, there's something besides the three networks. And suddenly a president could speak at 2:30 in the afternoon and go right on TV and not have to wait for a soundbite at 6:30 that Walter Cronkite would deign to put on the air. That was a big deal. 96 comes Fox and MSNBC. Now there are more voices. Then comes the internet, more voices. Presidents have always had layered media strategies. We'll talk to the nationals, we'll talk to the regionals, we'll talk to the local paper. I'm going to this state now. You see it with Biden. He's going out, he's going to states. He wants to be on the local and regional press because he's delivering a message to that state. So they've always had that. But now I think it is hard, bordering on impossible to govern, because you have so many audiences in so many different places. And to your great question about whether people can tell what's right or wrong, what's real or fake, to the point that you've got social media constantly saying, no, that's wrong, this is the other thing, he's a bad person, she's dishonest. It is a burden. It's their job, they gotta do it, they don't have a choice, I agree. One of my favorite lines is a few years ago, I had the privilege of having five former secretaries of state on the stage with me at George Washington University. And we were on the verge of a presidential election. And I asked each of them, what's your advice to the president? And Madeleine Albright had the greatest line. She said, Mr. President, just remember, you wanted this job. and so it goes with the territory, but the territory has gotten much more difficult to navigate. Better in some ways, more complicated in others, and that's just the world we're in.
Has anyone ever read the hate mail that President Lincoln used to receive?
Right. Yeah.
It's vitriolic, right. Like Twitter or X or whatever it's called. Extraordinary.
We have had a great conversation here this evening, and we could go on. I'd love to listen to you for our lecture. But we should call it, because in the world of social media, we've exceeded our post. But I want to thank again our wonderful, brilliant panelists for your insight and your thought. And I want to thank this incredible audience. You care, you show up, you ask great questions. And to this young man in the back, you stay with it, talk to him, talk to her.
Talk to Connie.
And we're counting on you to save our bacon, okay? And to the White House Historical Society, thank you a million times. Totally
thank great. You, Frank, and for our panelists tonight for joining us. I'm very excited to also be able to announce, and part of this is because of Frank, we are excited to announce that next year's 2024 series moderator will be Margaret Brennan. And the reason that Margaret will be joining us is because some of her team members came to a previous event here, and they sat in, and they loved the idea, they loved the concept, and it's because of Frank's work that is happening. And so again, thank you, Frank, for participating in the four-part series. And we will send out information. That date is going to be January 17th. And the theme for the 2024 series will be the White House and diplomacy. So we're looking forward to that and sharing that information with you all. Final notes, I did want to acknowledge Bob McGee. There he is. Hi, Bob. Bob, who served on our board for many years, who came in, I think, after Stuart had done his introductions, and Mary Lou McGee with him as well. Good to see you both. And I don't want to keep you any further from the reception back in Decatur House. So again, a round of applause for our panel. And we will proceed back out to Decatur House, and the reception will be upstairs. Yes,
before we go.
Of course.
The presidential radio news address. I am so sad it went away. There was so much news made. I'll never forget the day when Ronald Reagan sat down and said, testing, 1, 2, 3, testing. The bombing starts in 5 minutes. He was joking. We didn't know that. Have a nice reception.